In today's episode, I'm going to show you how you can run Tensorflow Lite on a Raspberry Pi, and also I will show you how you can create a very simple wildlife camera. And actually, I've been using it for the past few months, and it has captured some really interesting animals that do roam around in my garden. Let's start with the theory. What is Tensorflow Lite? As the name indicates, Tensorflow Lite is a light version of Tensorflow, which is designed to run on small devices like a Raspberry Pi, a mobile phone, or even a tablet. Tensorflow Lite is composed of two packages. One is the interpreter, which is what you normally use to run Tensorflow Lite for inference, and the converter. And the converter is what you use when you want to convert a normal TensorFlow model into a TensorFlow Lite model. It's important to know that you can't train models using TensorFlow Lite. You can only convert an existing TensorFlow model to TensorFlow Lite using the TF Lite converter, which is the tool I referred just now. TensorFlow is an end-to-end open source machine learning platform that includes TensorFlow, the open source library, Tensorflow.js for running TensorFlow models with JavaScript on a browser and on Node.js, and TensorFlow Lite, which basically allows you to run TensorFlow models on a mobile or embedded device. While it is possible to run TensorFlow directly on a Raspberry Pi, it takes a long time to load the model into memory. It can take several minutes, actually, and it leads to a long startup time. And also, it's a lot slower to get the response from a model than what the typical real-world application requires. And take also into account battery consumption, which on a mobile device not connected to the mains is going to become a big problem. TensorFlow Lite tries to solve all of these issues by optimizing TensorFlow for edge devices. And the models in TensorFlow Lite are much smaller in size, occupying a much lower memory footprint and having a much faster startup time than typical TensorFlow models. Okay, so all the steps I'm going to follow in this tutorial are in this article that you can see in here. This article, I'm going to put the link in the description so you can follow along. You can read what TensorFlow Lite is, and this article explains it very well, but for now, I'm just going to go straight to the steps you need to perform. Well, you can see here, my Raspberry Pi. I already have the wildlife camera installed, but I'm going to show you the steps from the start. So the first thing you need to do is you need to update all your packages in the Raspberry Pi. Now that we've updated the Raspberry Pi, we need to reboot the Raspberry Pi. Now it's time to install Docker. We shouldn't forget to reboot as well, and then we should also check that Docker is installed properly. Finally, we need to install docker-compose. Now that you have your Raspberry Pi camera set up, it is time to download the source code, which will have what you need for the wildlife camera. So copy and paste this line here, open a terminal. I've already installed this, but I'm going to show you how to do it again. Git clone, and then the repository. You should see all the files inside a subdirectory called Raspberry Pi Docker TensorFlow OpenCV. So go inside that. And here you have one Docker Compose file, which is what you need to start a wildlife camera. Before we start the wildlife camera, I'm going to show you some of the parameters that you might find important. So open this docker-compose wildlife camera.yaml. You'll see here an entry point, and this points to the script that starts the camera. And then it also has a list of objects here. It is configured by default to detect. This is based on what I need. So in my case, I'm detecting birds, cats, and dogs, okay? But you can also detect more things. You could also add here person or whatever the model that you're using allows you to detect. Another thing that you could also specify, which I don't specify here, is the threshold. So by default, the threshold will be set to 0.5. If you want to change that, you can set the threshold via this command line argument. So minus minus threshold, and you can specify something like 0.5 or something else. What that means is that if the TensorFlow model is certain about given object class 50%, 0.5 or more, then it will include that detection, right? So if it's below the threshold, the detection will be discarded. But if it's equal or above it, it will also consider it. So sometimes if you're testing something, and maybe in my case, my model wasn't working very well with my camera and what's in the garden, so I had to lower the threshold to be able to get some detections. And this is good if you want to get some test data so that you can basically refine your model later on with the test data. If you already have a good enough model, normally it's better to have at least a threshold of 0.5, if not more. Okay. Another command line argument you might want to use is enable -tpu. What this command line argument does, you'll have a Coral USB attached to your Raspberry Pi. I will use it, okay? And you might be wondering, oh, I don't see any models here, right? How does it know which model it's supposed to use? In answer to that, we have the script itself will download the model automatically for you. I'll show you the code. So all the code is inside the tf-lite folder, and the main class is wildlifecamera.py. So here you can see in this class that we have here all the command line arguments specified here. So you have the threshold, which I already explained. You have this command line argument is kind of enable TPU is the one that you will use if you want to enable your Coral USB. Then here you can specify the list of objects that you want to detect. By default, it will be a bird, but you can override it as you wish. Then if you want to integrate this with a communication channel like Slack, then you can use this option here, which is the minus Slack. It should point to the Slack credentials. So if you have Slack, then you configure this file config.ini with your credentials. You can see more information on the actual how-to guide. If you're wondering how the wildlife camera knows where to download the TensorFlow models from, all you need to do is look at the scripts folder, and you'll see start camera script, and you'll see that there are steps here that will download a model for TensorFlow Lite. This is a standard TensorFlow Lite model without using Coral USB. If you don't have Coral USB, you'll be using this model. Otherwise, there's another model I'm downloading, which is for the Edge TPU for Coral USB, and I already specified the URL here. So if you wanted to change this model with your own model, you can. All you have to do is change this URL here, and it will download the model and place it inside the TFLite directory. Make sure the labels also match the model, right? So make sure whatever link you provide also contains the labels for the model. So now we know all the different arguments we can use. Now it's time to start our wildlife camera. And that's about it. So if your camera is up and running, then you can see a process called camera. And what this will do, it's going to wait for something to happen. And whenever a new detection, something is detected and it matches the detections that you've configured, it will send you a notification on Slack. And it will also record a video, as we can see inside this folder. And you can see I already have lots of detections here. So I can show you one. So this is an example of a detection it's made. So you can see here, we've captured foxes, more than one actually. It looks very slow because I'm connecting remotely to the Raspberry Pi. You might be wondering, how do I know that my camera is working? Now I'm going to show you how you can debug the wildlife camera if something is not going according to plan, because you might have followed all the steps and for whatever reason your camera is not working, maybe, or something else is wrong. So in order for you to test that everything is working as it's supposed to be, then what you should be doing is to change the docker-compose wildlife camera, duplicate this line, okay, just for temporarily. And instead of starting the camera straight away, we're going to do a tail, and we'll be doing tail to dev node. Okay. Now we're going to stop the wildlife camera, and we're going to start it again. And this time, the actual Docker container will start, but the camera itself will be not started. You need to go inside the Docker container, okay? And then you go inside this directory here, /app. In another terminal, you should write this xhost plus. This will allow the Docker container itself to connect with the graphical user interface of your Raspberry Pi. Okay, so now let's start the camera. Yeah, and we pass in the object. You can just review very quickly here. Objects minus objects, so minus objects, then person, cat, and maybe a bird. Okay, and then here you pass in the argument minus debug, a window with the view of the camera, and this will allow us to debug what's going on in the camera in case something went wrong. It might give you an error the first time. This is the bug, not in our code, but it's something to do with the memory access. Ignore it. You should be able to try again, and it should work the second time. So as you can see, this is the view, the current view of the camera. Yeah, so I know my wildlife camera is working because I've enabled debug, and I can see exactly what the camera is seeing. And you can tell that the model itself is not very smart. It almost thinks that this pot here is a person, right? It's not very confident about it, right? So yeah, that's it. This is how you debug your wildlife camera. Okay, other than that, if all is working well, then you can change again the Docker compose, and you can disable the test entry point. You can try it again, okay? The Docker compose down and up again, and this time it will run in the background and you will not see the window for the camera view, but it doesn't really matter because you should know it's working by looking at the box. If all goes well, you should not see any errors. You should see something similar to this. Maybe a bit more debug just so. Okay, right. So this is all for now. I hope you found this video useful, and I hope you have great success with your wildlife camera. In the next episode, what I'm going to do, I'm going to refine a Tensorflow model for object detection, because the model I've been using until now, it's not very good at detecting foxes, for example, or it somehow confuses dogs with almost everything. I need to improve the Tensorflow Lite model so that I don't have as many false positives. So that's all for now. I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope to see you again soon, and happy coding.